morning, ladies and gentlemen. So my name is Mohamed Ali-Adraoui. I'm a senior fellow at the Middle East Institute, National University of Singapore. I am more than delighted, you know, to chair a very promising panel dealing with the history of modern Syria. As you know, this country is in real trouble. That's why we need very substantial long-term perspective and outlook, historical outlook. To that end, we are welcoming three very distinguished panelists and speakers. Daniel Neep from Georgetown University, Eberhard Kienle from the French Institute of the Near East, and last but not least, Peter Sluglett from the Middle East Institute at the National University of Singapore. Our first speaker, Daniel Neep, is an assistant professor at the prestigious Georgetown University. His presentation is titled, Is Syria an Artificial State, or Why the Sykes-Picot Narrative Asks the Wrong Questions? Daniel Neep is assistant professor in politics at the Center for Contemporary Studies within the Edmund Wall School of Foreign Service. He was previously lecturer in Middle East politics at the University of Exeter, UK, and research director at Syria at the Council for British Research in the Levant, in which capacity he was based in Damascus during the first year of the uprising. In 2016, he was awarded a fellowship at the Woodrow Wilson Center for International Scholars to continue his research on state formation in Syria. He is notably the author of Occupying Syria Under the French Mandate, Insurgency, Space and State Formation, published at Cambridge University Press a couple of years ago. And his new book is titled The Nation Belongs to All, The Making of Modern Syria, that will be published by Alan Reid Random House in 2017. Thank you very much, Daniel Neep. We're very happy to have you here.
Thank you for the kind introduction. It's a great honor to speak at this conference today, and thank you to the Middle East Institute for the invitation. It's especially an honor to be speaking following such a wonderful presentation, keynote speech from one of the most respected scholars of Syria, and also to be on the same panel as with two other most respected senior scholars of the history and politics of modern Syria. I'm a little fearful, in fact, that my intervention in this panel may be a little more than an intellectual mise en bouche for the rather more substantive food for thought that will follow. But nevertheless, I hope I can serve as some kind of tasty appetizer. At this point of the conference, I thought what it might be useful for me to do is to try and draw a connection between non-academic and academic discourses regarding the origins of the conflict in Syria. And what I want to begin to do is to explore the problematique announced by the very title of our conference, Understanding the Syria Crisis. What exactly is the nature of that crisis? How do we conceptualize this? How do we conceptualize the crisis as a crisis? And how do we define the parameters of what constitutes that crisis? Now, some of you in the audience may feel that this is something of an unnecessary debate, or at least you may be confused as to why we want to spend two whole days to discussion of a question that already seems settled in the minds of almost anyone, really, who follows the media coverage of the Syrian civil war with any degree of consistency. Reading between the lines of much recent journalism from correspondents in the field, reports from think tanks, and commentary from leading foreign policy pundits, there is a surprising consensus regarding the root cause of the Syria conflict. Namely, the fact that Syria is not a naturally occurring viable polity, but an artificial state carved from the carcass of the Ottoman Empire in the secret Sykes-Picot Agreement of 1916 and refined by subsequent Anglo-French machinations. Now, over the last few years, there have been numerous examples of this particular narrative of state crisis in Syria. The end of Sykes-Picot, asks Itamar Rabinovich in a 2013 paper for the Brookings Institution. The unraveling of the current political order in the core of the Middle East, he says, may reshape the strategic landscape. Is it the end of Sykes-Picot, inquires Patrick Coburn in the London Review of Books. Sykes-Picot is dead, exclaims Lebanese politician Walid Jumblatt somewhat dramatically to the independence veteran Robert Fisk. Do Iraq and Syria no longer really exist? Wonders a headline on the foreign policy blog in tones of rather breathless alarm following ISIS's declaration that had unilaterally erased the borders between the two countries in 2014. I'll leave you to guess what foreign policy's answer to this question was. So how does this common Sykes-Picot narrative establish that the borders drawn in the wake of World War I are responsible for the bloody civil war and carnage that afflicts Syria today? Well, this narrative I suggest, identifies two principal causal mechanisms. The first is that the so-called Sykes-Picot states were drawn without regard for pre-existing social, economic, political, or cultural alignments. This produced a non-correspondence of actually existing states and the latent divisions of communal identities such as ethnicity and sect. Lebanon, Syria, Iraq, from this perspective, are representative examples of the category of artificial state. Each is putatively identified as a chaotic mishmash of different sectarian and ethnic groups with few common loyalties. Societies containing religious and ethnic diversity, this narrative implies, give rise to structural instability on a political level. The second way in which the origins of these states is held to account for the current situation, the second part of the equation, is that the inherent artificiality of these post-Ottoman states prevented them from winning the consensual support of their populations. To compensate for their lack of natural legitimacy, state builders in Syria and elsewhere resorted to coercion and repression, producing authoritarian institutions of government that are brutal yet brittle. Theostates, as Nazih Ayoubi memorably calls them, or to use the language of historical sociologist Michael Mann, high in despotic power, but woefully low in infrastructural power. So from this perspective, the Sykes-Picot states are not only politically unstable, structurally, but they're also inherently inhospitable to the emergence of democratic regimes. On the face of it, Syria seems to fit this narrative perfectly. It is comprised of heterogeneous religious ethno groups, dominated by an Alawi minority, ostensibly propelled to power by being so heavily drawn into the colonial armed forces by the French, and compelled, because this regime is inherently illegitimate and unrepresentative, to use overwhelming violence against dissenters, as the events of Hamer in 1982 and the more recent uprising illustrate very clearly. Secondly, because of its inherent artificiality, Syria is perhaps uniquely susceptible to the allure of alternative supranational ideologies, Arab nationalism, transnational Salafi jihadism, or subnational centrifugal forces, the particularisms of the Druze and the Alawis and Upper Jazeera in the early 20th century, or the radically anti-pluralist doomsday suicide cult of the Shabiha, al-Assad or Nahr al-Balad, al-Assad or we burn the country. The assumptions of this Sykes-Picot narrative, I want to suggest, underpin much contemporary policy and media discussion. And yet, and I suspect you may know where I'm going here, the tenets of the Sykes-Picot narrative are profoundly and quite fundamentally wrong. Now, this argument, I hope, will not come as too much of a revelation for academics in the audience who focus on Syria, but it is an argument I have felt obliged to articulate on numerous occasions when speaking to students, the wider public, and policymakers and government officials over the past 3 or 4 years. When speaking to audiences beyond the echo chamber of right-thinking academics, not right-thinking, when speaking to audiences outside academia, I think it behooves us to highlight the numerous historical and conceptual errors that are embedded in this Sykes-Picot narrative. And given the audience today, I'm going to do this in rather quick-fire fashion. Number one, France did not create a unitary state of Syria, but a series of truncated statelets in which they tried to inculcate autonomous movements among provincial elites, often along sectarian lines. Think that an Alawi state is more natural than an artificial Syrian state? The French tried it, didn't work. Number two, the very notion of internecine conflict between sectarian and ethnic groups motivated by ancient enmities is not only profoundly primordialist, but it is actually grounded in a colonial ethnographic discourse of a so-called mosaic society that overlooks the changing dynamics, the changing nature of intra and inter-communal relations over time. Number three, the emphasis on the external borders in the Sykes-Picot narrative comes at the expense of thinking about the internal institutions. The borders may indeed have been drawn by the French, but the introduction of modern state institutions did not begin with the instauration of the French mandate, commenced under Ottoman rule in the 19th century. If you think about processes of pacification, legal reform, the reform of landowning rights, even the formation of chambers of commerce and this type of institution that becomes so important as kind of sounding zones for economic policy from the 50s, even to more recently, all these institutions were and processes were begun in the 19th century. The fact that the Syrian state, we think about it in these terms, did not begin in 1920, but began five, six decades earlier, helps to explain perhaps why it has been so successful, why it has been so long-lived. Number four, the Alawi community in Syria did not take power because they were catapulted into the colonial and hence national militaries on the basis of French colonial policy of typical divide and rule. Firstly, the Alawis were disproportionately recruited into the ordinary ranks by the French, not the officer corps. After independence, the Syrian armed forces underwent what might be called a recertification in the 1940s, before the purges of the 1950s and 60s changed again its political and demographic composition and led to the emergence of sect-based cliques in the 1960s. So sectarianism and this, and the way we understand the composition of the regime today, is not a direct consequence of the borders laid down in the 1920s. It's much more recent. Number five, the Sykes-Picot narrative cannot explain the rapid and ultimately successful, I would argue, development of nationalism in Syria, both economic and political, from the late 1920s onwards. Even today, it's often overlooked that the civil war is being fought for control of Syria by Syrian actors, not for the dismemberment of Syria. Of course, you're going to point out ISIS. I'm going to argue ISIS is not a Syrian actor per se. So I can get out of that. Number six, the focus on violence, coercion, and repression within the Sykes-Picot narrative overlooks the more subtle instruments of legitimation developed by successive regimes, from the personality cult of Assad to the seductions of neoliberal economic pleasures, as Lisa Wadeen has so amply documented. The Syrian state may be fierce, but it has also deployed symbolic and ideational power alongside that of its violence. And you may say, yes, of course, the proportions have changed since 2011. But even today, I saw the Syrian Ministry of Tourism has released this wonderful promotional video inviting us all to visit the beautiful beaches of Syria. There's this wonderful camera panning over golden beaches and looking at green hills. This is not simply frivolous. The regime is still investing a considerable amount of time in propagating these narratives and maintaining this symbolic discourse. Why bother doing that? There is a real reason for it. Number seven, the focus on sect obscures the impact of the importance of social class, as scholars such as Ray Hindbush and Steve Heidemann have made so clear in their works. More concretely, the Sykes-Picot narrative also leads to faulty policy options for the present day. Number eight, one of these options in my particular bete noire is the idea that we can redraw the map of the Middle East more accurately to reflect the demographic realities of the region. And from this point, we get these weird and wonderful cartographies, much beloved of the New York Times and other outlets, featuring such entities as Alawistan, Shiistan, the Sunni Republic, the Tetrapolis, Arabia Felix, the kind of super Vatican state of Mecca and Medina. I have written at length about the delusional imperialistic hubris of this cartographic imagination elsewhere, so I'm not going to excoriate its idiocy today. I'm happy to do so at length in questions and answers if you prefer. Needless to say, I do not think redrawing the map of the Middle East is something we need to be, kind of cartographic engineering is at best a phantasm. Number nine, the Sykes-Picot narrative produces the mistaken assumption that the solution in Syria lies in power sharing along confessional lines. Along the Lebanese model, as the Norwegian foreign minister has recently put it, for anyone with a cursory knowledge of the Middle East, the idea that a Syrian version of the Règlement Organique, al-Misaq al-Watani, or the Taif Accord is the best formula to bring end to the conflict in Syria is quite frankly risible. Now, I could go on with these false assumptions of the Sykes-Picot narrative, but I won't. I'm sure you get the picture. And I can expand on any of these points in the questions and answers. What concerns me about the Sykes-Picot narrative is not only its remarkable proliferation, but also its the relentless march of its rhetorical appeal to non-specialists. No matter how many times we refute its arguments, demolish its analytical premises, or unpick its claims to truth, the Sykes-Picot narrative keeps coming back ever stronger than before. Much like the narratives of Orientalism and primordialism, the Sykes-Picot narrative is what I like to call a zombie narrative. No matter how many times we kill it, it rises again from the grave to stalkers, creating ever more converts whose assembled masses are impossible to kill. So perhaps the time has come to find a different weapon to slay these zombies of essentialism and historical determinism that I think are embodied in the Sykes-Picot narrative. So, having made these preliminary remarks, what I'd like to do in the 20 minutes allocated to my presentation, that was a joke, please don't look so worried. What I want to do in the remaining time is to suggest that instead of explaining the Syria conflict in terms of being part of a universe of cases defined by their common inheritance of the structural legacies of Sykes-Picot, we should instead reconceptualize the Syrian conflict as part of a universe of cases defined by the phenomenon of state crisis. Now, in the academic fields of historical sociology and historical institutionalism, there is a considerable literature on state crisis, for the most part elaborated in the wake of Theodore Schochpel's seminal work on the causes of revolution in the late 1970s and the subsequent revival of state-centered analysis from the 80s to the present day. Now, scholars who adopt a neo-Weberian understanding of the state generally conceptualize state crisis in terms of the state's objective structural inability to maintain its essential functions. And this usually takes two forms, in very crude terms, or I'm rendering in very crude terms. We have, for example, a shortage of funds, a shortage of material resources, crudely put, creates a fiscal crisis that opens, renders the state apparatus vulnerable to contestation, to revolution from below. Alternatively, there might also be a deficit of consent that produces a legitimacy crisis that has the same effect of producing vulnerability. For any neo-Marxists or anyone who's familiar with neo-Marxist state theory from this period as well, they kind of echo this formulation by speaking of the inherent contradictions between the state strategies of capital accumulation and legitimation with similar implications for revolutionary movements. If you're not a neo-Marxist, you don't need to worry about it. Now, clearly, this notion of the notion of state incapacity and how state incapacity functions and creates vulnerabilities has much to tell us about the Syria crisis. As the kind of political economy explanations of the context of the uprising demonstrate, and how more recent work on social movements, defections from the army, how individuals break through the wall of fear in Syria. A lot of this literature feeds into our understanding and kind of gives us a richer understanding of this vulnerability. But what I want to do is not to refute this work, quite the contrary, I think it has within it a great deal of insight, but I want instead to highlight two consequences of thinking about state crisis in Syria and elsewhere in such material and structuralist terms. Firstly, we often assume that state crisis is objective, that there is a kind of objective balance. The state loses money, loses resources, loses coherence, and that we can somehow measure this. And this kind of approach, if you take that assumption, it follows that actors will adopt strategies that are also interest maximizing and efficient, or rational, as social scientists like to say. So from this perspective, Assad all will burn the country is not out of touch, is not insane. It's actually reasonable, well, reasonable from a certain perspective, but a logical response to the revolution. Response is not a stupid, repression is not a stupid thing, as Reinhard Lenders has recently put it. There is a rationality, there is a calculation, an interest maximizing calculation that goes into the mobilization of coercive resources. Secondly, this idea that crisis is material assumes that we as analysts are somehow able to pierce the veil of confusing empirical reality and objectively define the dimensions of state crisis, that we can adequately assess the reach and capability of state infrastructural, despotic, and symbolic power, that we can potentially measure the moment, or at least define the scope conditions in which that state power becomes weak and collapses, that we can somehow grasp exactly what is involved. We can calculate the proportions. You know, when does the state actually become so weak that this happens, that we actually can ever get a sense of this? And I'm skeptical about each of these assumptions about state crisis. I want to suggest that scholars of Syria might usefully look at a different approach to understanding crisis, one that has been articulated in a slightly different literature within what is known as constructivist international political economy. I'm thinking here about work by people such as Mark Blythe, Colin Hay, even Bob Jessop. Many of these scholars have been looking in particular about economic crisis in the Western world and how fiscal crisis from the 1970s, more recently in 2008, creates a moment of opportunity and restructuring. In these kind of fundamental moments of crisis, actors can take the opportunity to kind of revisit institutions, reform those institutions. Now, these scholars agree on two things that we can learn from them, I think. Firstly, they point out that given that crisis is overdetermined, we can never definitively or objectively define what a crisis is. There's simply too much going on. There are too many factors to feed into our analysis. What were the causes of the 2008 financial crisis, for example? You know, it's almost impossible to come up with an objective material definition of what fed into that. What they suggest is that actors adopt competing interpretive frameworks to elaborate competing causal accounts of the crisis, and because of that, they advocate different measures to resolve it. So there is no one way in which we can define a crisis and come to consensus on it. All we can do is develop a narrative of that crisis, elaborate accounts that highlight particular elements of the crisis, and then develop a solution or a path forward, policies to implement on the back of that. The Sykes-Picot narrative, I think, is a really good example of one of these interpretations, albeit one that I do not particularly agree with. Secondly, they point out that the aftermath of crisis is not determined by actors' material interests. It's not read off from their relative positions within a materially or structurally defined field of power. Interests do not come with an instruction sheet, as Mark Bly pithily observes. Interests must inevitably first be discursively constructed and defined. If you look at the history of Syria in the 20th century, there are numerous instances of state crisis that I think we can look at and draw parallels with regarding the current situation. I'm going to highlight very briefly just two of those. The state crisis in the mid-1920s, whereas the colonial state faced its biggest challenge from the Great Syrian Revolt, was responded by the French not with armed force according to any efficiency or rational idea of repressing the rebellion. Quite the contrary, as I point out in my earlier book, the use of colonial violence was actually structured through really odd ideas about the nature of Syrian society, about the utility of armed force. It wasn't a rational interest-maximizing response to the rebellion on the ground. It actually was refracted through particularly culturally held understandings of the nature of that society and the utility of armed force. In the immediate post-independence period, Syria also went a similar state crisis, I would argue. That led to actors, the national bourgeoisie, the military, pushing for a particular narrative, particular diagnosis of the crisis that led them towards a statist economy. And similarly, if we look at the present day, I think there are a couple of takeaway points that we can build on from this understanding of crisis. Firstly, if we start to pay more attention to the narrative construction of crisis rather than to the objective balance of power, it might perhaps give us a different way to think about the kind of problem, one of the problems that's been recurrent in analysis over the past 5 years, which is that, you know, how does the regime keep going? People have been predicting that it's going to run out of time, energy, people, resources, objectively, at various points since 2012 onwards. There's a certain elasticity there that we can't quite get to. We can never pin down the exact extent of these resources. Perhaps this gives us a different way of thinking about doing it. And secondly, the point about violence as well, and the point about state violence in particular. Violence is not always, or even necessarily primarily, a tool that is used instrumentally by actors to achieve rationally defined interests, not necessarily to achieve an upper hand in any military situation. A lot of the violence we've seen is performative. It's done to enact a particular world vision. It's done in terms of to compete with other actors. I mean, these various Islamist groups, or the various groups in Syria, are not all Islamist. They often, you know, adopt Islamist garb, produce these wonderful videos of themselves doing these wonderful military operations, which are sometimes purely just spectacles. A friend of mine was doing 2012 was wandering around the desert doing camera work for some of the rebel groups. He said they just, you know, put on their clothes, explode some rockets in the desert and send a message back to, take a video of it, send it back to their funders in order to keep the money coming. So there's a performative element to this that we simply don't get by thinking of the objective and material nature of the crisis. So I'm going to leave it at that. And we'll be happy to take further questions later on. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Daniel, for this very thought-provoking presentation. Now it's time to hear from our second speaker, Eberhard Kienle, who is the director of the Institut Français du Proche-Orient, the French Near East Institute based in Beirut. He's research director at the French National Center for Scientific Research. He previously taught at the St. Anthony's College at Oxford, at SOAS, at the Institute of Political Studies in Grenoble in Paris in France. From 2001 to 2007, he was the head of the Institute for Research and Study on the Arab and Muslim World in Aix-en-Provence. From 2007 to 2010, he coordinated the program Governance and Civil Society at the Ford Foundation Middle East Office in Cairo. And his publications include Baas versus Baas, The Conflict Between Syria and Iraq, 1968-1989, A Grand Delusion, Democracy and Economic Reform in Egypt, and Democracy Building and Democracy Erosion, Political Change North and South of the Mediterranean. Eberhard, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Muhammad Ali, for this wonderful introduction in which I don't really recognize myself. I didn't know that my, well, I would say pedigree or my curriculum vitae was that long. I've forgotten all about it, really, but anyway. So many thanks also to the organizers of this conference to have me today. It's very nice to be here in many ways. I love coming to Singapore. It's also one of these opportunities for me to, make my brain cells work again, because as you know, I've become a bureaucrat over the last couple of years, and it's always very nice to run an institute, but if you think there is power related to that, or the exercise of power, don't think so, it is not. And of course, we were not very much interested in that. So what I want to do in the next couple of minutes, or 20 minutes, I think I got 20 minutes, is first of all to disappoint you twice. To disappoint you first of all, because I will not talk very much about Daesh. I'm getting bored with Daesh, it's in the title. The more I thought about my paper, the more I thought it was more interesting to talk about the struggle or the struggles for Syria. Daesh will be part of it, but it's a minor actor in my talk today. I will talk a little bit about it, but not that much. Other people do that maybe more eloquently than I can do it. I will also disappoint you after the first speaker, because there will be some echoes of the Sykes-Picot narrative, which has been sufficiently debunked so far, but I will not go as far as relate all the evils of Syria to Sykes-Picot. In fact, I didn't even want to talk about Sykes-Picot, but now I have to. And I will also certainly buy very much, the argument about state crisis. In my view, if you hear anything about Sykes-Picot here or about the nature of the Syrian state, it will not be explaining everything in the terms of Sykes-Picot. So I want to go back to Patrick Seal, to his seminal study about the Arab, about the struggle for Syria. This published, this book, I got it here, in fact, I can show you, a seminal study published in 1965 about, the post-war politics, post-independence politics in Syria. And Patrick Seal, in his book, dwells extensively about the role of external actors in Syrian politics in the period from independence 1945, actual independence 1945, but roughly to 1958, to the beginnings of the United Arab Republic, in which Syria was sort of fused with Egypt. It covers the period of the so-called Parliamentary Republic, and of course also these not quite parliamentary military regimes, these military regimes in 1949 and onwards, and their civilian allies. They were never really quite military, there were military regimes, but of course they're very careful to have their civilian allies, as many military regimes try and do. Now the notion of external actors, of course, refers to all those who are not Syrian in the sense of being nationals of Syria, and those who largely act from outside the borders of the Syrian state. Now, just to remind us of what Patrick Seal talks about, it's of the great number of Arab and also non-Arab actors, of course, neighbors of Syria, but also further afield, who vied for influence in the country, and who, of course, all got their local allies, and who would, of course, try to cooperate with these actors. Now, we have, first of all, Saudi Arabia and Egypt and Iraq as the main sort of external actors who try to play a role in Syria. and we have Turkey, Israel as main non-Arab neighbors, and of course we have other actors like France, and then increasingly of course the superpowers, the United States of America, the USSR, who include, or Syria becomes included in this period, ever increasing ever more into the nascent Cold War, and of course the Cold War overdetermines Syrian politics, as also of course Malcolm Kerr in his equally seminal Arab Cold War explains and analyzes. Now, what is important to remember, of course, is that all these external actors, and Patrick Seal mentions that as well, all these external actors, they may take initiatives, they may have an idea about what Syria should be like and where Syria should be in their various alliances, but of course they all rely on local actors in Syria, on Syrians. And very often, of course, it's also the Syrians who take the initiative. It's not only sort of nasty external actors who try to use Syria and Syrians, but also Syrians, of course, they take the initiative and they try and shape these relations to their own advantage. There are plenty of examples. I can't go into these examples. I mean, the Hinawi period, one of the second, even Zaim, the first, who, in fact, his name bore his name very well, Zaim, as a military leader and as a coup leader, of course, Zaim, that's wonderful. He was one of those who, of course, instrumentalized or tried to instrumentalize external relations with external actors. The same, of course, is true for the second military ruler, for Hinawi. I just want to give one example, which is perhaps more on your minds, and that's the United Arab Republic. As we all know, the United Arab Republic did not come about because Gamal Abdel Nasser wanted to vassalize or wanted to take over Syria. It came into being because Syrians, largely the Syrian Baathis, went to Cairo and asked Gamal Abdel Nasser to accept this union. And so we have a prime example of where Syrian actors, the Baathis largely, but not only the Baathis, and also not all Baathis, in fact, where the Baathis took an initiative to ally themselves with a non-Syrian actor, an external actor, the Egyptian government at the time, Gamal Abdel Nasser, to bring about that union. And that's, of course, one of the examples that, I mean, well, are key to the argument of external and internal actors working together at that particular period. And in a nutshell, if you want, the struggle to Syria boils down to actors in a politically divided state entertaining privileged relationships with external actors. Sometimes the solicitations come from abroad, sometimes they come from inside. Now, if you look at this sort of narrative, which is the Patrick Seal narrative, then you see obvious parallels with today. Today, we are in a roughly similar situation. It's maybe a new, well, there was the classical struggle for Syria. Maybe today, we're in a new period of struggle for Syria, in which, again, we have internal fragmentation in the Syrian state, and we have very strong external links of the various fragments of the various actors and forces on the ground. Even alliances, of course. Now, just to illustrate, of course, we have Assad and the ruling group, or the regime, however you call it, with Russia, Iran, Hezbollah, but also Egypt to an extent. We have the Free Syrian Army, which is the so-called West, and the US, and Turkey, Jarablus these days. We have the Kurds, the Syrian Kurds, who are, more or less allied at the moment with Russia and the US. And we have, of course, numerous Fasail or numerous other smaller groups with all sorts of actors, Saudi Arabia and others in the Gulf. And then, of course, we have the inevitable Daesh, and we have the Nusra with other local actors, many of them, other regional actors. And, of course, also, we should not forget that especially Daesh, of course, in a sense, has external support way beyond the Middle East, from Europe, from America, from so-called Western countries, but also, of course, from other Muslim countries. So there are alliances between internal actors and external actors, and in that sense, of course, we are once again in a country which is divided internally and in which numerous actors have external relations, and we're not in the presence of something that, well, IR experts or realists would call a unified actor with one unified policy. The obvious difference, of course, we'll talk about other differences in a moment, but the obvious difference, of course, is that the old struggle for Syria, the classical struggle for Syria, was conducted maybe with different means, different ways and means than the new struggle for Syria. Today, of course, it's a military conflict. In the old days, it was not quite a military conflict. It was diplomacy, it was intrigues, it was coup d'etats. It was certainly in the 1940s and 50s less violent than today. That's an obvious difference. It's a difference. We will come. We'll talk about other differences in a moment. Now, the two periods of struggle for Syria, the old, the classical one, and the current one, they contrast, of course, heavily with the period in between. There was a period in between in which Syria, the Syrian state, appeared to be pretty strong, in which the Syrian state appeared to be, of course, these ideal types never exist, but it appears almost like a unified political actor in international relations terms, especially in realist terms. I'm talking about the Hafez al-Assad period, when everybody thought there was a strong Syria, a strong Syrian ruler, and a Syrian regime that, of course, tried to shape and managed very much to shape its local environment, its regional environment, to its own advantage. Now, just to remind you, in the Assad period, 1970 to 2000, 30 years, almost 30 years, 29 and a couple of months, Syria was very active in the policies of the region, and there was very little external meddling in Syrian affairs, although of course there was always, but it was quite different from the period of the classical struggle for Syria or of today. Just remind you, Syria and Egypt take the initiative for the 1973 October War with Israel. Syria from 1976 onwards plays a major role in Lebanon, dominates Lebanese politics for almost 30 years, and by that, or by dominating Lebanese politics, also has a very, very heavy impact on Palestinian politics. Syria, in this period under Hafez al-Assad and also later, supports the PKK against the Turkish government, in contradistinction with most Arab governments, all Arab governments, in fact. Syria, in the Iran-Iraq war between 1980 and 1988, supports Iran, which is quite extraordinary because Syria was alone among Arab countries to support Iran. Syria, of course, enters into an alliance with Iran after the 79 revolution. Now, in 1990, 1991, Syria sides with the United States and Russia as well, or the Soviet Union at the time, in an international coalition to liberate Kuwait, to drive, so to say, a preliminary nail into Saddam Hussein's coffin, and to prompt the defeat of Iraq as a regime and sadly also as a state, its long-term regional competitor. So Syria in this period, in the 1970s, 80s, 90s, up to 2000 about, Syria was very much an active political actor, or the Syrian regime, the Syrian government trying to represent the Syrian state, was a very strong regional actor, quite different from today when, it governs part of the country and other major actors in Syria have their own external relations. Now, Syria seemed to be strong. It was partly strength, it was partly, I think, an illusion of strength. Now, Hafez al-Assad, in this period, he came to power in 70, ultimately, he managed to combine three elements, I think, which are key for the exercise of power. Repression, cooptation, and legitimacy. And those, of course, who read German political scientists know that this goes back to my friend Wolfgang Merkel. Now, repression hardly needs to be illustrated in this period. Just think about Hama, which was a prime example of repression. So the Syrian regime, of course, mastered repression, but also legitimacy. And I'm pretty sure, although legitimacy is difficult to measure, but I'm pretty sure that the Syrian regime enjoyed a great degree of legitimacy, partly because of its Arab nationalist stances, partly because of Ba'athi ideology, which is not only Arab nationalism, which is also some sort of, revolutionism, socialist aspects, and cooptation, of course, also, because the old Ba'athi social contract still worked, or worked very much so, in the 1970s, 80s, for the peasants, for organized labor. There was a constituency for this regime in Syria. This constituency, the regime changed its constituency over time, especially with the first Infitah in the 1970s and even more so with the second Infitah in the 1990s, when it increasingly opened up to the private sector, entered an alliance with them. It shifted its internal alliance from, say, the workers and peasants, to caricature, to the private sector. Nonetheless, it maintained, of course, an internal constituency, which in various ways it co-opted, and it managed to do so up to a moment, but then, of course, this all broke down. Now, this ability to repress, to legitimate itself, and to co-opt, very much depended, of course, on favorable external, favorable international circumstances, which Hafez al-Assad, I suppose, cleverly used, but which, of course, also facilitated his claim to power. They strengthened his regime, and they allowed him, of course, to, or these international conditions strengthened his regime partly because it enabled him to find internal support as well, partly because it helped him to repress, to co-opt, and to legitimate his regime. Now, first of all, of course, we think about the Cold War. Syria was a major Soviet ally in the Cold War, as long as the Cold War was still a fact or matter of fact, a fact of life. It was the Soviet window on the Mediterranean. He was a Soviet ally against Israel. Although at the end of his regime, you all remember, this alliance was put to a test when the Soviet Union under Gorbachev decided to ask Syria for cash to get Soviet weapons. Syria was also, of course, and from 1979 onwards, as I said earlier, a firm ally of Iran. So it had Iranian support, it had Soviet support. It had, from 1990 on, when the Kuwait crisis, very cleverly, Assad, I think he understood very early, that of course the Cold War was coming to an end, that the wind was turning, and he turned his coat with the wind, and he operated that rapprochement with the United States without losing Soviet support at the time, and to be on the right side of history in the liberation or the reconquest of Kuwait. He understood quite clearly what the new world order was about. In conclusion, one could say, once again, that the Assad regime is an example of a regime stabilized by external rather than internal forces, although, of course, the external support helped it to find internal support. Now, this happy period of international support, say from 1970 to the 1990s, that came to an end because of the end of the Cold War, and also, of course, because this internal, sorry, you're saying 5 minutes, but the timekeeper hasn't yet.
5 minutes, but it's enough.
Oh, right, okay, well, I'm reassured, okay. So that came to an end for two reasons. Partly because of the end of the Cold War, and related to that, of course, because of Infitah, and because, of course, the Syrian regime, in order to stabilize itself temporarily in the 1990s, needed to open up to the new global powers, needed, in a sense, to open up to globalization, which supported it for some time, but would also weaken it in the long run. Now, in the new world order, of course, the repression was no longer that easy, cooptation changed, legitimation was no longer the same as before. Now, that tells us one thing about the nature of the Syrian state: the old struggle, the new struggle, and in between. That tells us something about Syria, which is rather a territorial state than a nation state in the Qurani distinction. It's a state where territory and population and the legal entity of the state do not necessarily coincide with an imagined communities, and thus with a community of loyalty and solidarity of all nationals. Imagined communities, of course, in the Andersonian sense. Now, that does not mean, to come back to the previous paper, that does not necessarily mean that the nature of the Syrian state as a territorial state decides and determines everything. And I think, indeed, there is a place for state crisis in a territorial state, although, of course, it may in a territorial state take different shape. Now, I'm coming to the last part of what I'm going to say, and that is the differences between the old and the new struggle for Syria. So except for this period of, say, Assad's rule, roughly, which was sort of facilitated by favorable international circumstances, we have Syria as a precarious entity, as a precarious state, with two struggles for Syria. Now, what are the differences between these? We already talked about one difference, which is the degree of violence, which we detect today in today's struggle for Syria, and which was not the same in the earlier struggle for Syria. Now, there is another and maybe more important difference, and that, I think, and which leads to this one, to the difference in terms of violence, and that is that the external solidarities of Syrian actors in the 1940s and 50s were not sectarian. They were with other regional powers, with the Iraqis, with the Egyptians, with the Saudis, and so on and so forth, or with non-Arab actors. But it was not like today that you would have a, say, Alawite, we have to be very careful, of course, a so-called Alawite regime that's allied with Hezbollah and with Iran, and that we have Sunnis that are allied with Saudi Arabia. There is no sectarian dimension to that in the 1940s and 50s. There are external actors, but there's no sectarian dimension. And it seems to me that the more the sectarian dimension becomes part of this game, the more violence is on the rise. There is a third difference, and that is the impact on borders. The old struggle for Syria, either the external borders were respected, or unity attempts with other states, in particular Iraq, were launched, or with Egypt, of course. Now, today, we see signs of disintegration of the Syrian state internally. So the drawing of, say, new boundaries, new borders within the Syrian state. That's a difference. And again, I think it has a lot to do with the rise of, say, identity politics or sectarianism. We have a fourth difference, and I think that's the important one, a very important one that I already mentioned earlier, and that is that the new struggle for Syria is also fueled by the identity-based or sectarian decomposition of what looked like nation-states in Europe. Indeed, many of the people who fight for Daesh, and there we come back to Daesh, many of these people, they come from Europe, sometimes from America, or at least not from the Middle East. So we see, say, something like a state crisis, not necessarily only in the Middle East, but also elsewhere. And we see either, to come back to a debate that rages in France in these days, but I think elsewhere as well, we see either people who are radicalized Muslims, or we have radicals who become Muslims, just to refer to this interminable and largely sterile debate that rages in French academia and in the press. Now, how can we explain these differences? Well, I think, and that's my last word, I think I got 0.1 minute, I suppose. That is indeed, I think, that sectarianism, collective identities, identity politics today are maybe even more important than in the past. And with very important effects on violence, it makes politics more violent, with effects on the drawing of borders. We live probably in a world today in which vertical cleavages of society, not only in the Middle East but elsewhere, are far deeper and far stronger than elsewhere. So, and that's my last word, if imperialism, and that brings us now to say, instrumentalist and not primordialist interpretation of the territorial state. So if imperialism had a major impact on sectarianism by exacerbating, even producing, identity-based cleavages among people forced to live within the same state and to vie for power and resources in that state, then I suppose globalization, it's a hypothesis of course, then globalization has further deepened such cleavages by increasing competition within and beyond state borders. And I think that's the difference between the old struggle for Syria and the current new struggle for Syria. Thank you.
Huge thanks to you, Eberhard. Thanks very much for this. I'm sure they are going to be very, very interesting questions. Our final speaker is very dear to me. Peter Sluglett is our former director at the Middle East Institute. He's now visiting research professor. So he has, of course, prestigious degrees like from Cambridge and from Oxford, PhD at Oxford, BA from Cambridge. He has taught Middle Eastern history at the University of Durham for 20 years and at the University of Utah, Salt Lake City for almost 20 years, where he was a director of the university's Middle East Center. He has published widely on the modern history of Iraq, including Iraq since 1958, from revolution to dictatorship, and Britain in Iraq, contriving king and country. He has also edited and contributed to the urban social history of the Middle East, Syria and Bilad al-Sham under Ottoman rule, essays in honor of Abdul Karim Rafiq, and so on and so on. Thank you very much, Peter, and the floor is yours.
Well, I'm delighted that this conference has come to fruition, and for this we have to thank Linda in particular, and of course Huda, Sharifa Huda, and Zubaida, and Retna, who have worked tirelessly to put this together. I have been writing a book on Syria for far longer than I should, but what follows is a summary, let's say, of a chapter called The Syrian Economy Under the Assads, From Bad to Worse. And you'll be happy to hear that this is chapter 8 of a book. Well, you may or may not be happy to hear that this is chapter 8 of a book, and I have to write chapter 9, which is essentially what happened since 2011. So if I don't do this before Christmas, I shall be very upset, and my wife will be even more upset. So this is, of course, not sort of original research in the sense that it summarizes the work of many people in this room, you know, to whom I'm extremely grateful for their, for their intellectual production. So let me get into this. Traditionally, the Syrian economy was based on rain-fed agriculture, animal husbandry, especially raising sheep for wool for the urban textile industry, small-scale urban industrial artisan manufacture, often of luxury goods, and long-distance trade. As early as the first half of the 19th century, there was a lively trade in land and evidence of the commercial exploitation of agriculture, all of which is visible in the records of the Mahkamah Sharia, the Islamic courts. Towards the middle of the century, Syria began to import manufactured goods from Europe, particularly textiles, but local manufacturers were quick to adapt. By the end of the century, spurred on initially by the American Civil War, Syria exported a variety of primary products, including cotton, grain, and silk. The region, which we call Bilad al-Sham, gradually became integrated into the capitalist world economy. Since the middle of the 18th century, private ownership of agricultural land in the Ottoman provinces had been a kind of unofficial reality through the system of malikane, lifetime tax farms. The property regime was formalized under the terms of the Ottoman land law of 1858. While the state retained the ultimate right to the land, the right to cultivate, or the right of usufruct, tasarruf, became the property of the cultivator, and as such, that right could be legally inherited and bequeathed as well as bought and sold. Hence, those in a position to do so acquired and consolidated substantial tracts of land, which led to the formation of large private estates in Greater Syria and Iraq from the second half of the 19th century onwards. I mean, one of the distinctions, the classic distinctions between, let's say, Europe and the Ottoman Empire was that, you know, theoretically, there was no hereditary landowning aristocracy in the Ottoman Empire. But in fact, by the middle of the 19th century, there was, and before, if you look at it. This process was mostly accompanied by the pauperization of the peasants, because the Ottoman government initiated a more thoroughgoing policy of tax collection. When the peasants couldn't pay, they borrowed from landlords or other moneylenders. After a while, they were often obliged to hand over the title to their lands to pay off their debts, and they stayed on the land as sharecroppers. Until the sort of mid-20th century, I would say, rural to urban migration was relatively uncommon, since the cities offered few opportunities for employment, in other words, few beyond what the urban inhabitants could do. In the late 19th and early 20th centuries, emigration, mostly to Egypt and to the Americas, became an important safety valve. There seems to have been little major demographic change until the middle of the 20th century, when more regular rural to urban migration began. At the same time, the gradual spread of modern medicine and the wider availability of medical care meant that more children survived infancy. So by 1943, population was 2.86 million, 65% rural, 35% urban. Post-independence governments claimed to be interested in economic development, but most of the development that took place before the Ba'ath, especially the swift expansion of irrigated wheat and cotton cultivation in the Jazeera between the 30s and the 50s, and the setting up of weaving and spinning factories and workshops in Aleppo, was undertaken by private entrepreneurs. The main exceptions, that is, infrastructural activities undertaken by the state, were the construction of an embryonic road system, the expansion of the port of Beirut, and the draining of the Rab marshes on the Orontes in the 1950s. Now, all this changed in the 50s and 60s with the enactment of two major land reforms, the first in 1958 during the union with Egypt, the second in 1964, and the nationalization of much of commerce, banking, and import-export, and of large-scale industry in 1964 and 65. The land reforms effectively limited the amount of land an individual could own, thus bringing revolutionary change to the Syrian countryside. The takeover of agriculture, industry, and commerce meant that the state took over the control and management of the economy, a state of affairs that largely persists, albeit with many vicissitudes. Thus, Syria became a centrally planned economy like Bulgaria or Romania. By the time that Hafez al-Assad took over in 1970, the Syrian state had been running this kind of centralized planned economy for just over a decade. The state also became the largest employer of labor, as was the case in Algeria, Iraq, Egypt, and many other etatist economies at the time. The guiding principle, however unrealistic processes of globalization have now made this seem, was to detach the national economy from the world economy, which, as those in charge saw it, involved turning a weak state into a quasi-autonomous one. Initially, at least during the late 60s and 70s, Syrians enjoyed relatively high living standards, with GDP per capita growing at about 6% per annum. Many basic foodstuffs were subsidized, and education, health, and welfare services were, at least in theory, available to everyone. In the countryside, agricultural cooperatives, agricultural credit banks, and institutions for purchasing crops at guaranteed prices were created, thus guaranteeing minimum incomes and improving living standards for most of the rural population. Expropriation of land was also carried out to ensure that the feudal landlords would not return, although land redistribution only began in earnest in the late 60s. A great deal of well-intentioned idealism accompanied these measures, particularly in the beginning, although in common with experience elsewhere, inefficiencies in delivery, coordination, and infrastructure meant that the first few years of land reform showed a sharp decline, or were accompanied by a sharp decline in agricultural production. Until the mid-70s, and in fact for much longer, agriculture constituted the mainstay of the economy and the biggest employer of labor. In 1970, 51% of the population was employed in agriculture. By 1981, this had dropped to 26%, although this was still the largest sector. The fall was partly a result of mechanization and partly because of massive rural to urban migration, fueled by the expansion of the state sector and its function as a major employer. Although another important factor was that the simple credit structures to which the peasants had been accustomed had disappeared with the landlords. Peasants would hold on to the land that they'd been allocated in the villages, which might be worked by their parents or siblings, and went to the cities to find better educational opportunities for their children, jobs for themselves in construction, or less demanding unskilled jobs in the burgeoning public sector. Between the 60s and early 80s, Syria gradually developed a more comprehensive manufacturing sector, as well as an embryonic oil industry based on its fields in the northeast, encouraged by soaring oil prices after 73. For most of the period between the discovery of better grade oil in the 1980s and the beginning of the war in 2011, Syria was self-sufficient in oil, which provided a quarter of national revenue and much of its export income. Syria had been manufacturing textiles for domestic and foreign consumption for many centuries. And in the late 20th century, large amounts of textiles, clothing, bedding, furniture, coverings, and so on, often made in small workshops employing a few workers, were exported to the Soviet Union and Eastern Europe, usually within the framework of various barter deals. There were some oil boom years, but agriculture always formed the bedrock of the economy and of exports. As a result of its location as a frontline state in the Arab-Israeli conflict, Syria enjoyed fairly substantial aid from the Arab oil states between 73 and the oil crisis of 1986, amounting to approximately $1.6 billion a year in the late 70s. Which gave it the means to invest in industry and various public works, including electricity, irrigation, and road building projects. During these years, Hafez al-Assad, who'd never been a particularly enthusiastic advocate of socialism, gradually modified his government's ethicist thrust and introduced a degree of economic liberalization. His corrective movement encouraged private enterprise and in the investment of foreign capital. So in the late 70s and early 80s, the government sold much of the sequestered agricultural reform land that had not been redistributed, loosened import controls, and selectively abandoned limits on foreign currency exchange in order to encourage private investments. And there were no sweeping nationalizations after 1973. In addition, as already noted, world oil prices rose substantially just as Syria was beginning to export oil, and for these reasons the country enjoyed something of an economic boom, albeit rather a short-lived one. Again, the 70s and early 80s marked the heyday of development in the Gulf, from which many Syrians sent remittances home. However, in March 1986, the price of oil fell to $22 a barrel. And although there were good years and bad years, oil prices did not resume an upward trajectory till the early 2000s. To add to these economic woes, there were severe droughts over much of the past three or four decades, although human mismanagement was at least as important in accounting for the damage done as natural shortages. Syria also considered it necessary to spend quite large sums on defense. The remittances from migrants in the Gulf gradually dried up, I mean, not entirely, but considerably. Syria's richer patrons found themselves in more financially straitened circumstances. Maintaining the Syrian presence in Lebanon became increasingly expensive, especially after the Israeli attack in 1982, and Syria did little to endear itself to its patrons by supporting Iran in the war with Iraq between 1980 and 88. By the mid-80s, the outlook for the economy seemed fairly bleak, and that by the end of the decade, Syria could no longer, of course, rely on preferential economic treatment from Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union. Nevertheless, perhaps contrary to expectations, the regime managed to avoid major economic crises until the early 2010s. According to Volker Perthes, writing in 1995, this was possible at least until that point, 1995, because of the existence of a state class reflecting, quote, the development of a non-entrepreneurial, self-recruiting ruling stratum which controls the means of coercion as well as a major part of the means of production in highly interventionist or state capitalist third world countries. Interestingly, Perthes asked at the time whether, quote, economic adjustments will eventually imply substantial shifts or even fundamental changes in the power structure. As we know, such shifts did not take place either in Syria or anywhere else, indeed anywhere else in the Arab world. And the absence of any fundamental political change and the increasing latitude given to the crony capitalists was a major factor behind the accumulating discontent that burst out in Syria and the rest of the Arab world in 2010-11. Hence, although growth rates were quite positive till the early 80s, this was followed by a slump in domestic product from which the Syrian economy took many years to recover. It was only in 2007, the most recent year for which these figures are available, that average per capita income overtook the figure of $1,695 it had reached in 1982. In 1989, for example, it fell to 815. During the 80s and 90s, reflecting the prevailing international neoliberal consensus, the Syrian regime embarked on a program of extensive privatization, accompanied by the phasing out of subsidies and the shrinking of the public sector, encouraging its supporters in the private sector to take over state institutions or fulfill contracts on its behalf. Best known of these measures, of course, was Law 10 of 1991, a package of measures designed to revive the private sector,
part of a trend towards more global realignment on Syria's part in the post-Soviet world. Syria had opposed the US invasion of Kuwait, had agreed to take part in the mid-conference in October 1991. Now the Syrian economy was to be reoriented in a market-friendly manner. Law 10 permitted Syrian and foreign investors to invest in virtually anything they liked, except for tourism, banking, and insurance. It restored private ownership, gave tax exemptions, tax holidays, and so on. The result was that by the early 1990s, more than half of Syrian economic activity was in private hands, which the neoliberal consensus deemed to be a move in the right direction. However, Law 10 and other measures were not particularly successful because investment was not steered towards those sectors of the economy that would benefit from it, but also because of the confusing regulatory and judicial environment, since many earlier and more restrictive laws relevant to a command economy remained in place, as well as the more general absence of the rule of law. In sum, foreign investors did not feel safe, but local businessmen, especially those with ties to the regime, began to make their fortunes. By 1995, with Hafez al-Assad failing physically and distracted by ultimately fruitless negotiations with Israel, cooperation between the regime and the business networks had begun to falter, and the economy was in even more serious trouble, with corruption playing an increasingly destructive role. The regime was anxious to move away from economic stagnation and decline, but its only option seemed to be to enter into further negotiations with members of the local business networks. Many members of the bureaucracy, the military, and the security service had become part of the business elite. Those close to the president's family, especially the Makhloufs, Hafez al-Assad's wife's family, given that they were by definition both part of the ancien regime and of the succession, were in a position to extract even greater profits from the regime's weakness. Further reforms were introduced, introduced under Bashar al-Assad in the general direction of freeing the market and liberalizing trade, though many deterrents to doing business in Syria remained. Transparency International ranked Syria at 154th of 168 countries in its listing for 2016. Regime officials and their relatives routinely shared the profits of new business ventures, which could not be set up without their participation. At the same time, public sector wages were frozen between 1994 and 2004, and the labor leadership had been co-opted by the 80s. Needless to say, this resulted in widespread poverty and unemployment, especially in the countryside. In 2009, the average worker's income was $274 a month, while average household expenditure on food was $295. In addition, Linda Matos' fieldwork shows that the official rate for essential commodities between 2006 and 2010 was at least three times the official rate. By the early 2000s, both the economy and the various social pacts into which the regime had entered had begun to falter even more seriously, and the population had risen from 10.5 million in 85 to 16.5 million in 2000. So, as will be clear by now, the Syrian economy has been on a collision course against popular demand and the country's needs, at least by the 90s. There was some brief sense of respite for a few months after Bashar al-Assad's succession in 2000, but when it became clear that any meaningful political concessions would threaten the economic dominance of the old guard and those close to it, repression was resorted to again. Those demanding greater political liberties and greater political participation were accused of being traitors, enemy of the state, enemies of the state, and so on, because, of course, greater political liberty would inevitably ask two, let's say, awkward questions being asked about mismanagement and corruption in the economy. This was a vicious circle, since the political structures of the 2000s could only be maintained by effectively paying off the ruling elites. By 2011, Syria was virtually isolated in the Arab world and from Turkey, formerly a close eye, but protected by China, Iran, and more recently Russia. The affairs of the regime and the elites were too deeply penetrated, too deeply enmeshed to disentangle. Writing early in 2012, Ray Hinnebusch pointed out, should the regime collapse, the relative absence of strong state institutions independent of it could well leave a vacuum that would not be smoothly filled. So I'll finish. The crisis in 2011 bore some resemblance to the situation in Iraq in 2003, although the path of large-scale external intervention was not chosen, presumably because of the very negative results this approach had produced in Iraq. By mid-February 2016, the war for Syria had caused 500,000 deaths and nearly 2 million wounded. 11.5% of the country's population have been killed or injured since the crisis erupted in March 2011. And of course, you have internal displacement, refugees, and so on. It's a profoundly depressing situation, as others have noted, the more depressing for seeming so utterly intractable. Thank you.